Is there a role for breathing re-education in otolaryngology? We have to bear in mind that the physiological breathing mode of the human being is nasal, regardless of age. And any factor that's leading to upper airway obstruction causes nasal breathing to be replaced by mouth breathing, among which mechanical events, allergic and non-allergic inflammatory diseases. But the key point here is, even when these mechanical factors have been removed, mouth breathing continues in most cases due to the patient's mouth breathing habit. Now we have to bear in mind that by the time a patient presents at an ENT, they have been mouth breathing possibly for many years. Any nasal obstruction is going to create air hunger when the individual, either the child or the adult, tries to nasal breathe. And as a result, it is inevitable that an obstruction to the nose is going to result in mouth breathing. When we're looking at the clinical trials, evidence often seems mixed in terms of sleep. Here I look at a meta-analysis of 9 clinical trials. External nasal dilators were used in 5 studies. Topical applied steroids in 1, nasal decongestions in 2, and surgical treatment in 1 study. The researchers concluded that chronic nasal obstruction seems to play a minor role in the pathogenesis of obstructive sleep apnea. But the real question here we have to ask is, even though the nose was treated, did the individual use it? Because you can treat the nose, you can open up the airway, but it doesn't automatically mean that the individual is going to breathe through it. I had rhinitis myself from at least 1975, 1976. I had an operation in 1994. And my turbinates were reduced, and also I had a deviated septum, which was relatively fixed. But I was never told to breathe through my nose afterwards. So from 1994, post-surgery, till 1998, I continued mouth breathing. I had a really poor sleep, my asthma was getting progressively worse, and my attention and my concentration in university was so adversely affected. And when I switched to nasal breathing, and within 2 days, my sleep improved dramatically. Most children with obstructive sleep apnea have difficulty breathing through the nose. Allergic rhinitis is the most commonly cited disease, followed by hypertrophy of the tonsils and adenoids. Even when adenoids and tonsils are removed, the persistence of mouth breathing post-TNA plays a role in progressive worsening of the apnea-hypopnea index. The relapse is approximately 65% and it occurs frequently within 3 years. Thousands of children are presenting to have their adenoids and their tonsils removed. But the practice of breathing re-education is not always happening. We really need to ensure a successful outcome and a long-term outcome in these cases. The treatment of pediatric obstructive sleep apnea and sleep disorder breathing means restoration of continuous nasal breathing, both during wakefulness and sleep. Now, the co-author of this, in actual fact, the lead author, is Dr. Christian Guimeneau, and he coined the phrase obstructive sleep apnea. He also developed the apnea-hypopnea index. And he goes on to say in a different paper that, in fact, restoration of nasal breathing during wake and sleep may be the only valid complete correction of pediatric sleep disordered breathing. Hyperventilation syndrome. In 2005, Dr. James Bartley authored a paper, and it included 14 patients who presented and they were complaining of nasal congestion after previous nasal surgery. Upon investigation, these patients appeared to have an adequate nasal airway. They had no evidence of nasal valve collapse, and they were evaluated for hyperventilation syndrome. It was noted that all patients had an elevated respiratory rate of greater than 18 breaths per minute with an upper thoracic breathing pattern. Now, how might that happen? Well, if you have a patient who has been mouth breathing for anything more than 6 months, but these patients may be mouth breathing for 2, 3, 5, 10, or possibly even more years. Mouth breathing is activating the upper chest and mouth breathing is fast breathing. So even when the cause of mouth breathing is removed, the behavior is maintained. So what would happen here is that because of a poor breathing pattern, when the nose was fixed and the individual is breathing through their nose, they may still feel air hunger, but they're not feeling air hunger due to inadequate nasal airway. They are feeling air hunger due to hyperventilation syndrome. Their breathing rate is fast, their breathing is upper thoracic, and both of these traits of breathing patterns need to be addressed. By normalizing the volume of breathing, by bringing the respiratory rate towards normal, and by switching from upper chest to diaphragmatic breathing, we can help to eliminate air hunger, to restore functional breathing patterns, and to enable the patient to breathe through their nose. The conclusion of this paper was that hyperventilation syndrome should be included in the differential diagnosis of patients presenting with nasal congestion, particularly after failed nasal surgery. Something that we're hearing more and more of is empty nose syndrome. And patients with empty nose syndrome following turbinate reduction often complain of breathing difficulties. In this paper here, they investigated patients who were presenting with empty nose syndrome. They investigated their breathing using the Nijmegen score, the hyperventilation provocation test, and also they had the patients hyperventilate and to see was there a delayed return in the partial pressure of carbon dioxide towards baseline. Hyperventilation syndrome was diagnosed in 17 out of the 29 patients, a factor of 77.3%. And this study suggests that hyperventilation syndrome is frequent in patients with empty nose syndrome, and that symptoms can be improved by respiratory rehabilitation. The pathophysiological links between empty nose syndrome and hyperventilation syndrome deserve to be further explored. Looking towards sleep disorder breathing, there are four traits involved in sleep disorder breathing, and breathing re-education will play a role in all four traits. The first trait that I'm going to look at is PCRIT, the pharyngeal critical closing pressure. And this refers to the pressure that's required to close the airways shut during sleep. Can we influence that with breathing re-education? Well, we know anatomically that if the mouth is open and the jaw is hinging downwards, and of course, with an open mouth, we're going to have a low resting tongue posture. So the tongue is more likely to fall back into the throat. And this in turn is going to reduce airway space, and this in turn is going to increase the negative pressure created during breathing. Nasal breathing is vital in order to help optimize the airway. The second trait that we look at is the stability of ventilatory chemoreflex feedback control, and this is loop gain. And individuals with high loop gain, they have an exaggerated response to the accumulation of carbon dioxide. So if they stop breathing for a period of time, carbon dioxide increases in the blood. When they resume breathing with large ventilatory response, and this is causing too much carbon dioxide to be removed from the blood through the lungs. As carbon dioxide is the neural drive to breathe, hypercapnia is going to reduce the stimulus from the brain to the breathing muscles. In other words, the individual stops breathing because the drive to breathe has been reduced. So individuals with high loop gain, which constitutes 30% of the population with obstructive sleep apnea, their obstructive events is also contributing to central events. The third factor that we look at is arousal threshold, and this is the propensity for individuals to wake from sleep. Individuals with a low arousal threshold, they wake very, very easy at the slightest stimuli to breathing. We need to help ensure a deeper sleep, and we do this by nasal breathing, but also by activating the parasympathetic response, and we can do that through breathing exercises. Slowing down the breath and using the diaphragm is crucial. And of course, diaphragmatic breathing will also play a role in the fourth phenotype that we look at, and that's recruitment of the upper airway dilator muscles. We need the dilator muscles in the throat, in the upper airway, to do their job, to maintain an open airway during sleep. When individuals put on a little bit of weight and there's fat on the abdomen, it compresses the diaphragm so that the diaphragm muscle isn't working as effectively as it should do. But our diaphragm muscle is also directly related to the upper airway dilator muscles. Diaphragmatic breathing is key in helping the upper airway dilator muscles do their job to keep the airway open during sleep. So in summary, there is a role for breathing re-education in otolaryngology. We have to bear in mind that individuals, both children and adults, post-surgery, it's really important that they have breathing rehabilitation, that they switch to nose breathing on a permanent basis, both during wakefulness and during sleep. This will improve post-operative outcomes, and it will also help to ensure a long-term success for that individual patient.